afternoon, everybody. Welcome to our last seminar of the session. It's my pleasure today to introduce to you our speaker, Dr. Dave Kelton. For those of you who don't know Dave, he's a faculty member in the Department of Population Medicine. He's a veterinary epidemiologist and has a large interest in dairy cattle health and management. He's got quite a few accomplishments I'm not going to read to you this afternoon, but it's my pleasure to welcome him. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Dan. It's a pleasure for me to present this seminar to the department. I applaud Dan for his persistence in getting those of us that are on faculty involved in the seminar series. I think it's important. I think a lot of times we get invited and we travel and we present our work, whether it's down the road or halfway around the world, and we very seldom take the time or find the opportunity to share what we're doing with those folks that are just down the hall or in the next building over. So this is a great opportunity, and I thank you for the invitation. Over the next 45 minutes or so, I will tell you a bit of a story about something that's been occupying a fair chunk of my time over about the last 3 years, and it's been a bit of a journey. We're getting closer to the end than we are the beginning, and it's been pretty exciting. And this is the National Dairy Study. I've subtitled this NAHMS North or Herding Cats, and I'll explain that as we go along. There's a reason for that. Before I go any further, though, two things I need to do. In the way of acknowledgments, I hate leaving those till the end because I may forget. So there are a number of people that have done the work that hopefully will make me look good. Kathy Bauman, who many of you know. Kathy is a postdoc working with our group, and she's really been the driving force behind a lot of the work that's been done, and I'll talk to you about, and a couple of our graduate students, Stephanie Croyle and Emily Bellage. Is Emily here? There she is, and Steph. Again, did a lot of the nuts and bolts and a lot of the on-ground work to get this rolling, so I appreciate that. Also, a lot of other people. I've got collaborators across the country and even in the US, and I'll mention those later. The other thing I wanted to get out right from the beginning, this work, quite a large undertaking, and it was funded through Dairy Farmers of Canada and Agriculture and Agri-Food Canada through the Dairy Cluster Research 2 initiative. So with that out of the way, on with the story. This story started a number of years ago. Some of you, maybe all of you, are familiar with what the United States Department of Agriculture does with their NAHMS program, their National Animal Health Monitoring System. It's a system that started in about 1990, and every year they do a benchmarking study of one of their major agricultural commodity groups, primarily livestock groups. Every year they pick one group, do a benchmarking study, and then rotate on to the next one. So the dairy industry, for instance, has had six studies now done over that period of time. These studies provide national data in the US about the health and management of their national herd or flock, depending on the commodity group. And this information is used very broadly in education, in research initiatives as background knowledge for writing grants and so on. It's used a lot in policy development in the US and overall indicators of improvements and advances that are made in the various industry groups, because every time they do one of these studies and repeat it in a commodity group, some elements, again, try to capture changes since the last time. So there have been six studies done by NAHMS in dairy over the roughly 25 years. The most recent one actually completed in 2014. We tend to use a lot of these data. We use them to understand things like what's going on in calving, reproduction, and milking practices in dairy herds. There's been an emphasis on antibiotic use, animal identification, and prevalence of a lot of the diseases that we're also interested in, mastitis pathogens, Johne's disease, VVD, and leukosis. In Canada, to date, certainly in the dairy industry, we haven't undertaken this type of a benchmarking study or activity. Those of us that give presentations quite often cite NAHMS data, and it's reasonably useful from the North American context, but there are some major differences in the Canadian dairy industry compared to the US dairy industry, and so some of those differences aren't necessarily reflected in what we can learn from the NAHMS data. Over the 25 years or so that I've been involved in dairy research, we've done a number of broad-based studies. A lot of these have been provincial and regional studies, and in many instances we've tried to draw that information together sort of in one location, or at least pool our resources, pool our knowledge, pool our results to try to draw some inference from a national perspective. Some of these examples are PLDC, CBMQRN, and CJDI, and since all of you, no, just kidding. I'll explain those acronyms shortly. The challenge has been we've used variable methods in selecting herds, in identifying samples, and in the tests that we performed. And so drawing all of that together into one snapshot of what's going on nationally has been a little bit challenging at times. The first example is PLDC, the Production Limiting Diseases Committee. In the late 90s and in early 2000s, driven primarily by our purebred dairy livestock industry, was interested in certain diseases and how much we had in Canada as part of a negotiation and understanding with some of our trade partners about which diseases we had, how much we had, and so on and so forth. So things like Johne's disease, things like BVD, things like leucosis and neospora were of interest. Over a period of about 5 years, there were four regional studies done. One in the Maritime provinces, one in Ontario, one in Alberta, and one in Manitoba. Again, in each instance, using a different selection process for herds, reasonably comparable testing strategies, but again, attempts to pool those data have been a little bit challenging. The Canadian Bovine Mastitis and Milk Quality Research Network, which has been in existence for about eight or nine years now, did develop a national cohort of dairy herds. The intent was to recruit about 100 dairy herds across the country and work with them over a period of a number of years to look at mastitis dynamics in those dairy herds. This involved herds in all four major regions of our country and used common methodologies. The challenge in that study and in that work was because of the requirement of those herds to stay on board for up to a two-year period, there was a bias in the types of herds that were willing to do that and stay the route. But nonetheless, it was a national opportunity at least to look at mastitis from that perspective. Over the last 5 to 7 years, we've had a number of Johne's disease regional programs running, one in Alberta, one in Ontario, there's been one in Quebec, and then one out in the Atlantic provinces. All of these have targeted Johne's disease, a disease of dairy cattle that we're quite concerned with. And yet the challenge in that is that while the core components of those programs involve testing and trying to get a sense of what the prevalence of Johne's disease was in each four of those regions, the methodologies used differed. In Alberta and the Maritimes, or the Atlantic region, for instance, they based most of their prevalence estimates on environmental fecal cultures looking for MAP, whereas in Ontario, we used a milk-based ELISA test to determine our prevalence estimates. Again, the methodology is different and we differed, and really we had no way of comparing one region to another and being comfortable that we were comparing apples and apples. So the idea of doing a comprehensive national study similar to NAHMS started about 5 years ago. As most good things do, it was over a beer with Jason Lombard. Jason is a veterinarian, works for the USDA, runs the NAHMS dairy studies. And during a National Mastitis Conference meeting, we were chatting about the NAHMS studies and we said, wow, wouldn't it be neat at some point to do a comparable study in Canada while they were doing a NAHMS dairy study in the US so we could draw some comparisons. And we chatted and went on to other discussions. couple of years later, when the Dairy Research Cluster 2 opportunity was announced, we thought, well, this might be the opportunity to do that. So during my study leave, I spent a little bit of time in Fort Collins, Colorado, where the USDA NAHMS team is based, to understand a little better their methodologies and how they approached their data gathering exercises, and recognizing that there were some differences, to see what we could build on and learn from their experiences. Jason was a key instigator of this and was very cooperative in this whole initiative and endeavor. I then recruited some partners in crime, specifically Herman Barkema at the University of Calgary, Jocelyn Dubuc at the University of Montreal. Some of you may remember Jocelyn. He was a DVSC student here with Stephen LeBlanc a number of years ago and is now on their ambulatory field service. And then Greg Keefe out at the Atlantic Veterinary College at the University of Prince Edward Island. Unfortunately, Greg has gone to the dark side since he's their dean now, but he still talks to us. And then Jason Lombard from USDA, and we put together a plan, secured some funding, and looked around and said, Kathy would be a perfect person to drive this, and so recruited Kathy and brought her on board and started from there. We had a number of objectives in trying to do this. Again, very similar to what they do in the US with the NAHMS initiative. We were interested in collecting some baseline data, some benchmarks, if you will, on health productivity and management. We wanted to estimate the prevalences of at least some diseases of economic or zoonotic importance. We wanted to investigate relationships and regional differences in herd demographics, management, and disease. We wanted to document the uptake of best practices in certain key areas, biosecurity, which has become a topic of conversation in the dairy industry recently, animal welfare, certainly, and actually milk harvest or milking practices. And finally, if possible, produce comparable data collected at the same time to allow some comparisons between Canada and the US. Unfortunately, because of our timeline and delays in securing the funding, we weren't able to conduct our study at the same time as the most recent NAHMS dairy study. We're a year behind, but we were able to, in fact, use some of the same methodologies, incorporate a few of the same questions that they used in our questionnaire, so we will have some of these elements where we can start to make some of those comparisons, which I hope will be interesting. The study, as we rolled it out, was really comprised of three major stages. The first was a planning stage. It was a little bit truncated, but the first thing we did is we followed the NAHMS model as much as possible. They were very cooperative and shared a lot of their resources with us. The first planning stage involved a needs assessment that was conducted in 2014, where we solicited input from as broad a stakeholder representation as we could, and I'll come back to that. The objective there was to identify some key areas that we could focus on in the study. We then had a series of consultations. And as part of the condition for funding under the Dairy Cluster Research 2, we also had to look at opportunities to collaborate with other Cluster 2 funded projects. And so that sort of all went on in the planning stage. Stage 2 was the actual data collection stage. That's been ongoing in 2015. The first phase of that was an online questionnaire. And then the second phase was a series of visits to 370 odd dairy farms across the country. And then stage 3, which we're into now, is building the database, pulling all of the elements together, making it accessible not only to researchers, but we hope eventually to all dairy industry stakeholders, and hopefully that will generate not only data for analysis and publication, but also interactive access by producers, by other industry personnel, and so on. So that's sort of an overview of our plan, where we've been and where we're going. The needs assessment was an interesting undertaking in that we wanted to get broad stakeholder input. We solicited input through a number of ways, through mailing, through posters, through ads and magazines, online, through Twitter and other social media opportunities. and really used a very short, about a 10-minute long online questionnaire, similar to what NAHMS does. We had over 1,000 stakeholders respond from across Canada. We were really quite pleased with that. And we grouped them into three broad categories, the first being dairy producers and farmers, and they were the biggest category. The second being folks working for or involved with government. We're thinking they're not only extension, but policymakers. And the third being sort of the industry support, veterinarians, nutritionists, and other allied industries. This is a figure that illustrates the response that we got by province to this needs assessment. You can see along the bottom that we actually had responses from all 10 of our provinces, which is what we sought to do. The largest proportion from Ontario and Quebec, not surprising because that's where the majority of our dairy herds, dairy cows, and our dairy industry is focused, but we did get good representation. 26% of the response was from veterinarians and allied industries, and in that we included university folks. 68% was from dairy producers, and again, this is for dairy producers, and so we were very pleased with that response, and 6% from people working with or for government. As part of this process, they identified or they gave us information and their perspective on what the top issues were in two broad areas. One is management and one is disease. We've broken this down by the three major groups, producers, government, and other. And again, the priorities across the top from first on the left to fifth on the right-hand side. You'll see there's a fair bit of overlap. For instance, reproductive health was a second priority for producers, third for people working with government, probably more on the extension side. Biosecurity was there in government and other. Antibiotic use was there in government and other. But the interesting thing was that the number one priority across all three of these groups was animal welfare. Should that surprise us? Well, given the timing early 2014, probably not. There was a fair bit of discussion because of some of the national initiatives on animal welfare that was a point of discussion. So that certainly may have influenced the priorities, but it was a consistent priority. And this exercise certainly gave us some direction about where we should go and what we should think about doing. Under disease concerns, we see a similar pattern. Again, the number one priority across all three stakeholder groups was lameness. Again, perhaps not surprising because that ties in with the welfare initiative, because lameness is probably one of our key issues around dairy cattle welfare. Other things, Staph aureus mastitis, Johne's disease, E. coli was in there, calf diarrhea and BVD, all sorts of good things. So again, more information for us and some guidance as to where we would go. So given that background needs assessment, given some of the other projects that were going on or just being initiated from the Dairy Research Cluster too, we then tackled the issue of developing a questionnaire as part of our phase one project initiative. Again, most of this fell on Kathy's desk. We had a lot of input, a lot of suggestions. We had questions that were posed by different partners, by our graduate students, by our research collaborators. Probably started with thousands of questions, and the challenge was to narrow it down and get it to something that was manageable, that we could at least have some hope that somebody would take the time to complete. Kathy worked on pulling that together. At the end of the day, we ended up with a questionnaire that included 113 questions, was 49 pages long, included all of these elements. Consent for us to access additional data through the provincial milk boards and through the milk recording DHI organization. Some information about herd demographics and farm characteristics, a bit on biosecurity, their attitudes towards infectious disease control, clinical disease prevalence estimates, including lameness, which was a major concern, calf health and management, animal care and welfare, udder health and milk hygiene, reproductive programs, and the last bit on internet and social media use. We then had to get that translated because it had to be available both in English and French, and then put it out there to dairy producers. and give them the opportunity to complete it and get it back to us. Our first choice, and we built this as an online instrument, but in order, again, to try to generate the best response we could, there was an option to have it in paper or, in fact, even to respond to the questionnaire by phone interview. So all of this happened, all of this came together, we hit send, and I had nightmares on three consecutive nights thinking, what do we do if nobody responds? Anyway, however, all was good. One of the challenges that we had, and this is where the herding of cats comes in, is that what we were trying to do is to reach dairy producers across the country. The NAHMS situation is a little bit different. They actually don't know how many dairy producers they have or where they are. So their first step in their commodity exercises is to do a census to figure out who's out there and who they might go after. We have a distinct advantage in our supply management system in that we know who and where every licensed dairy producer in the country is. So we know exactly where they are, we know who they are, we've got phone numbers, we've got addresses. Simple. The challenge is that contact information and all that detail doesn't reside in a single national body. It resides provincially with 10 different milk boards. Milk boards being composed of dairy producers all have their own personalities and their characteristics. Some are very forward-thinking, some are perhaps more conservative. They all had legitimate concerns about confidentiality, privacy, and all of these things. And so we had to negotiate with each of these 10 milk boards to access data and to access their mailing lists so we could contact these dairy producers. This was no small undertaking, and I think of all the things we did, it's probably the one that I most underestimated. Fortunately, we had the ability to rely on the relationships that we had established. And with the team that we had, Greg out east, Herman out west, Jocelyn in Quebec, and myself here in Ontario, we all had good working relationships with the milk boards and a lot of the producers on those boards. And it was through those relationships that we were able to finally convince them to share their data, to work with us and to cooperate with us. So with those 10 boards, the four of us, but again, Kathy was herding all of us and running, you know, we were running in all different directions and the milk boards, but ultimately we got it done. And I think it was a fantastic testament to the ability to get all of these different groups working together and in a sense of cooperation. Our response. Initially, we had a lot of discussion. How would we do this? As a good epidemiologist, I thought, well, we'll take a random sample of producers, we'll stratify by farm size and by region and do all these wonderful things, send out invitations and see who responds. Then as we sat and we thought it through, we said, okay, so we'll get a response. Some will agree, some will disagree. Those that don't agree to participate, we'll have to replace them. And eventually we want to get to our magic number, which based on a lot of sample size calculations and eventually the flip of a coin, we decided on 1,000 would be a really nice number because it's the first four digit number. No, anyway. So our target, my target was to get 1,000 herds from across the country in at least one or two herds in every province. At the end of the day, we decided the heck with sampling, we're going to send it to everyone. So we sent an invitation to every dairy producer through those milk boards, every producer in the country, at that time 11,962 of them. We got responses either online, through mail, or over the phone from 1,342 dairy producers, or 11% of the population. That exceeded my expectations by a fair bit. It's really quite phenomenal. Having said that, a response rate of 11%, we always worry about response bias. We always worry about, does that group represent that broader community that we're trying to make inference about? So the second advantage we have over the US NAHMS system is not only do we know who everyone is and where they are, we also have some baseline information that's collected on all dairy producer farms by those provincial milk boards, how much milk they're producing, what their cell counts are like, some measures of milk quality. And again, through our agreements with the milk boards, we have the opportunity, because we'll have this baseline benchmark data for all dairy producers across the country. We won't know who they are. We will only know the ones that agreed to work with us. But we can compare that group to that broader population and make some determinations of really how representative that group is of our national dairy population, which, when you think about it, is really pretty powerful stuff. And we're pretty excited about that. When you look at our phase one response, so these are the folks that either online, by paper, or by phone responded to our questionnaire. Again, we had representation across the country from all 10 provinces, the largest chunks being in Ontario and Quebec, as one would expect. Roughly 40% of our cows and herds are, or 40% of our herds, about 35% of our cows are in Quebec, about a third in Ontario, and the rest spread across the country. So our distribution mimics that really quite well, and we did have respondents in every province across the country. So again, we were thrilled by that. Just to tease you a little bit, and we're in the process of pulling this together, but to give you a sense of this population of herds that we've got this very rich data set from, 37 of those, or 3%, were certified organic farms. We don't have a lot of organic farms in Canada, but I think we've got a good snapshot here. 85% were enrolled in milk recording. From a national perspective, there are about 75%, about 78% maybe today, of dairy producers enrolled in milk recording. So our subscription on the milk recording side is maybe higher than the national average. Our distribution of housing styles is pretty consistent with what we see across the country. About 60% tie stalls, about 40% freestalls, and there are a few bedded packs and other arrangements out there as well. And that's, I think, pretty close to representative of what we see across the country. Regionally, a lot of differences. And 12% of the farms used robotic milking systems to harvest milk. Again, that fits pretty well where we think that number should be. We've passed 10%. We're moving towards 20% nationally. A lot of adoption of robotic milking, and we've got good representation of farms using that technology in this data set. So again, we're pretty thrilled by that. So then phase two of the study was, well, the questionnaire was fine, and we've sort of got a narrow spectrum of information in a lot of different areas. What we wanted through the phase two and the farm visits was to drill down and get a lot more depth in a smaller proportion of those farms to really get some increased richness. So we set that up. We set that up regionally. And for me, one of the exciting things that we tried and I think worked quite well was that rather than using paper to collect the data on these farm visits, we actually used tablet computers in the hands of our student research team, and they entered the data directly through those tablets into a web-based data system, so eliminated that need for paper. And overall, that worked really quite well. We learned a few things that I think if we were doing it again, we might do a little bit differently. Kathy's nodding yes. But overall, I think it was quite successful, and I think the students had a little bit of fun with that. Right, Jen? Yeah. Excellent. So during phase two, we visited 300, and I keep saying we, our student teams visited 371 farms. That was all done during this past summer, starting in about mid-May and going to almost the end of August. 81% of the producers that had responded to our phase one survey had indicated as part of that survey that they would be amenable and would be willing to receive a visit as part of the study. So we're quite pleased with that. We selected farms regionally based on a number of factors, but really we wanted regional distribution. Again, we wanted to be on farms in every province across the country. Logistically, that created some travel opportunities, particularly, you know, getting to some of the more remote regions, but we managed that. We also wanted to balance the milk recorded versus non-milk recorded to try to, again, get closer to reflecting the national average. One of the challenges and one of the things that people challenge us on when we're doing research in the dairy industry in Canada is that we tend to use milk recorded herds because they have all that richness of data, and that quite often our results don't represent that 25% of farms that aren't milk recorded. And so we wanted to make sure that those were represented as best as possible. This is, again, the distribution of the farms that we visited. Again, from a high of 132 farms in Ontario to four farms in Newfoundland, but again, got those done and have generated some wonderful data. Over the course of those visits, really there were three major objectives that our farm visit teams wanted to achieve and that we wanted them to achieve. The first was some validation and verification of some of the responses in that phase one questionnaire. One of the things that we worry about is that when we ask anybody their opinion on a questionnaire, are we getting the truth or are we getting the answer that they think that we want? Right? And in other words, you know, if we ask, what are you doing at milking time, are they going to parrot back what they think they should be doing or what they're actually doing? So we took this as an opportunity to observe some of the things they were doing at milking and during milking time, so it was a milking time visit, and some of the biosecurity practices that they had told us about. We asked some more questions, we made some observations. The second thing was, because animal welfare, dairy cattle care was top on the management priority list, we really wanted to delve in that a little bit further and generate some data. And so we did some animal care assessments, animal-based measures, and facility assessments during that farm visit. And finally, it was an opportunity to collect some biological samples for testing, both with implications for animal health and for public health. So as part of this project, we have partnered with the Public Health Agency of Canada. And so they're working with us on some pathogens of zoonotic interest, particularly salmonella and E. coli. These samples were manure and bulk tank milk samples. We also looked for opportunities to tie in what we were doing to other initiatives and other things that would make our work relevant from a national perspective. One such opportunity was the ProAction initiative that Dairy Farmers of Canada has launched, is in the middle of implementing, and so on. ProAction, for those of you who aren't aware, is a national initiative that's really aimed at quality assurance across the dairy industry. It has a number of key elements to it, including food safety, milk quality, environmental care, biosecurity, traceability, and animal care or animal welfare. As part of that, they had developed a pilot process for assessing animal care on dairy farms. They had done some piloting of that in 2014. What we did is we looked at this and saw this as an opportunity to take their methodology and apply it across farms across the country to A, see how well that methodology works, and B, to see if we can generate some benchmark data that could be used then in this ProAction initiative going forward. So we really built that piece, and that was large part Steph Croyle's work, to really take some of what the ProAction group had done, build that into our data capture mechanism, and think through the logistics of how we actually do that on all the different types of dairy farms, and that was not a small undertaking. And that really became part of the core element of our farm visits. When you look at that ProAction initiative and what we were doing, the timing worked out quite well. ProAction had gone through, they had national standards, which were based on the code of practice. They had developed a draft of a manual and a process. And so we could then take that, do a little bit of benchmarking, and thereby provide some standards or a starting point for a discussion about dairy cattle care across the country. The farm visits were carried out by a phenomenal team of students that worked with us during the past summer. There were recruited through the vet colleges, all five colleges, as it turns out, across Canada. Mostly veterinary students, some undergrads, and some technicians as well, and just a phenomenal group. We had them here. One of them, Jen Raymond, is sitting beside Kathy there. Again, when you hire a group of students, you never know what they're going to come with in the way of strengths, weaknesses, how well they're going to mesh as a team. Again, I was blown away by the enthusiasm, by the quality of the work that these folks did, and they certainly deserve a ton of credit for what was accomplished. At the beginning of that summer period, so in early May, we had all of those students here on campus for a week, but 3 days of fairly intensive training. We wanted to develop their skills. We wanted them to, when they were on farm, to make sure that they were operating safely, so occupational safety. We wanted to make sure that the data that they were gathering was accurate and that it was consistent, even though they were working in teams of two across the country, different regions. Clemence Nash worked with us, Steph, Emily, Kathy, in not only explaining what we wanted them to do, but how we wanted them to do it, and then going out on farm and having them do it. And during that process, look at inter and intra rater agreement to make sure that there was the consistency that we needed to collect high quality information. And then we set up a system whereby we encouraged them to communicate with us on a regular basis. We set up a listserv that probably wasn't used quite as much, but a lot through direct email and so on, to make sure that they were touching base and that any questions were resolved as soon as they could be. Some of this was really built around the challenges of working in very different farm environments. I wasn't going to get deep into this, but I wanted to use this slide mostly because Paula had some really cool animations in her slide presentation in her apartment seminar last week, and I didn't have any, so I stole this slide from Stephanie. But what this slide really illustrates is that when you're trying to identify or you're trying to get a representative sample of cows in an environment where their cows are constantly moving, it can be challenging. Cows are going all over the place, and so how do you ensure that you don't measure the same cow twice or that some cows don't get missed, and so on. So again, we had to think through protocols, think through strategies to make sure that we could address these on all farms, all configurations. At the end of the day, it all worked, and my thanks go out to all the folks that worked on troubleshooting that, including the students. They came up with some pretty cool and novel options of how to get this work done and get it done right. So a lot of thanks goes there. So where are we now? We're into the fall. The abundance of data collection has been done. The farm visits are done. The questionnaire is done. We're in the process of testing the biological samples. Enzootic bovine leukosis, the first round of testing has been done using bulk tank samples that we shipped out to the Atlantic Veterinary College. Those samples will be coming back to Guelph for some Johne's disease and Staph aureus testing, and then potentially to Quebec for some Salmonella Dublin testing. We're still in the process of working that out. We've got some of the fecal samples that are with the Public Health Agency of Canada looking at Salmonella and E. coli, and we've got samples that were collected as part of a parasite study out of the University of Saskatchewan. So all of that testing is in process. We are building a database, and Karen Hand, who has worked with us for many years, is helping us do that and bring all these elements together, link them together, not only with the data collected, not only with the test results, but also that background data that I talked about that comes from the milk boards and comes from CanWest DHI, to make sure that ultimately we have a database that's linked properly with all the proper herd identifiers and yet keeping it anonymized so that we don't know who the individuals are. Again, quite a challenging task. We have a number of graduate students who are using the data, three of them who are funded through the Dairy Cluster 2 initiative and have worked closely with this project. I've already introduced Stephanie and Emily. We have another student, Ashik Rahman, who's working with Jocelyn Dubuc at the University of Montreal, who I'll talk about here in a moment as well. And then as a final piece, with the help of Stephen Roche, and many of you know Stephen, we're looking to develop a portal to allow people to access the data. So other farmers, industry stakeholders, that would be an interactive portal where people could go and mine the database while maintaining, again, all the confidentiality that needs to be maintained, but where we could get maximum use of this resource across a broader industry. So again, we're looking at novel ways to do that and have applied for some KTT funding to take that forward. The three graduate students that are working on this project, Stephanie, and her area of interest and focus is the assessment of some key welfare issues on Canadian dairy farms. Just a little bit of a teaser, because I don't want to steal Stephanie's thunder. But our students during their summer visits did some lameness assessments, both in tie stalls and in free stalls. And as you can imagine, those processes are quite different, but again, have been validated and shown to give us comparable results. And essentially what we've found is that in freestall situations, the bar on the left, we've got about 24% of cows on average that have at least a mild degree of lameness or a mild limp. And in tie stalls, that number is about 33-34%. Certainly higher than the target or the goal that has been set out by Dairy Farmers of Canada and the ProAction Initiative. Probably not surprising, because these are similar findings to what were reported in the Dairy Research Cluster 1 project that Derek Haley and others were involved in. So again, we're, I think, in the right ballpark, certainly an opportunity for the dairy industry to make some improvement there. Emily is looking at impediments to adoption of best harvest practices for milk, milking techniques, and so on. As part of her questionnaire and her investigation, we looked at three things, amongst a lot of others: whether milkers use gloves at milking time, whether they use single service or single use towels to prep the cow, and whether they use a post-milking teat disinfectant. There we go, I do have some other information. So we've got some results from our current study. We also have some results to compare to about 10 years ago. Richard Olderinkerink was doing a PhD with Herman Barkema and myself, and did a similar, smaller scale survey as part of the Canadian Bovine Mastitis Research Network. And what we find is not dramatic changes in the use of teat dip, which is post-milking teat disinfection, which has always been high. Again, single use towels, whether they be paper towels or washable towels. Where we've seen quite a remarkable increase is in the use of gloves during milking, from 36% in 2005 to our current estimate of about 60%. Emily's going to be delving into, just because they wear gloves, do they clean them? Do they all do all the other things that they're supposed to be doing as part of that process? But again, so we'll be looking forward to that. And then I had mentioned Ashik, who's at the University of Montreal doing a PhD with Jocelyn Dubuc, funded through our project, and his interest is in biosecurity practices on dairy farms across Canada. Again, some teaser results and things that were of interest. One of the questions that we asked in the phase one survey was, in 2014, did you purchase at least one dairy animal? Almost 50% of dairy farms had purchased an animal and brought a new animal onto the farm. So thinking about from a disease introduction standpoint, what that implications that has. 25% of farms had cattle that temporarily left the farm and then returned, going to a show, going to a sale, going to a breeding unit, going somewhere for surgery or some other procedure. The diseases that these farms in general had and that they're working on to control, again, there was a large list, but the three most commonly identified were Staph aureus mastitis, digital dermatitis, and interestingly, ringworm came in as number three. Diseases that we then asked them, diseases that you don't have on your farm, but that you're actively trying to keep out. The three that were most commonly listed was BVD, or bovine viral diarrhea, Johne's disease, and the third most popular was any foreign animal disease, particularly foot and mouth disease. And then I had mentioned earlier that we had these regional Johne's disease control programs that had been implemented over the last 5 to 7 years. 43% of the respondents indicated that they either are or have participated in one of these voluntary regional control programs. And based on our estimates of enrollment by region, that's probably pretty representative of the national picture. I mentioned that we were doing some disease testing. We were using bulk tank milk samples. These are samples that milk represents all cows that have been milked into that tank. Bulk tank milk testing has some challenges in that you don't get an equivalent amount of milk in there from every cow. It varies by their production level and how much milk they were given on that day. Yet it is a fairly simple way to get at least a snapshot of what's going on in a herd. There have been tests that have been validated for use with bulk tank samples, one of which is a test for leukosis. And in fact, one of Greg Keefe's PhD students, Omid Nikoyi, has done some nice work looking at interpreting bulk tank test results for BLV. They've been doing the bulk tank testing. 87% of our herds were test positive for enzootic bovine leukosis. Not surprising, given all the other estimates that have done, this is coming in pretty well on ballpark. And then finally, one of the things that we were interested in was, how do we get information back out to dairy producers, both results of the study, but how do we communicate with dairy producers? What are they doing to access information, and how active are they in social media? So we had a section that address that. These, again, just a snapshot of some of the things that we learned. 80% of the farmers that responded to our phase one survey accessed the internet for dairy information in 2014 at least once. 94% of those did a search on Google or something comparable for a dairy-related question that they had. And 70% of them watched at least one YouTube video. So this ends up on YouTube, there we go. Maybe a few of them will see it. 63% of the respondents have a Facebook account, which was higher than I anticipated. And of those, over half accessed Facebook at least once a day, which is more often than I do, in fact. So I thought that was interesting. 18% have a Twitter account. Of those, 23% are active on Twitter daily. And 120, which is most of that 18%, shared their Twitter handle or name with us. So one of our plans is to do some mapping of social media to see how people are connected, how dairy producers are connected, who they're connected with. And we've got some key tweeties, whatever, in the audience here as well. So I know it's an area of interest, and it's a great way to get word out there. And in fact, I think Jane is back there tweeting as we speak. So we're in the process of starting to get this information out there, producing some fact sheets, summarizing some information, and so that will be forthcoming in the months and so on. And so all this work that's been done to generate this data, we're finally in the position where we're going to start feeding it out, and we're incredibly excited about that. With that, I will bring my presentation to a close. I thank you for your patience and your indulgence. And if there are any questions, I'd be happy to try to answer them or pawn them off on Kathy.
Do we have any questions? Somebody's gonna have a question.
Emma.
Great presentation, thank you. Regarding the on-farm site visits, how concerned are you about producers being on their best behavior? So on the questionnaire, you're worried about them telling you what you think you want to hear. On site visits, I can imagine them doing what you think they should be doing. So are you concerned about that? Is there any way you can control them?
That's a fantastic question. Since this is being recorded, I guess I'll repeat the question. Were we concerned about, I'd mentioned we were concerned that farmers would answer in the questionnaire what they thought we wanted to hear? Were we concerned that when we visited, they would do what we expected them to do rather than what they normally do? That's always a possibility, and we had long discussions about that. We tried to be as vague as possible about telling them what we were going to be looking at on farm before we got there, and so our hope was that they wouldn't necessarily change their normal behavior. I think the reality is anytime we go on farm, we impact normal behavior on farms. I think that's human nature. We disrupt their schedule. And again, I think it's human nature. Some people will probably be more attentive. They'll be, you know, but I think our general experience was, by and large, I think we got a reasonable reflection of what normal practice was. But again, always, you're absolutely right, always a concern. But I'm not sure how we do that other than stealthy videotaping, which I don't think would be appropriate. Charlotte?
The data that you get from the provinces, do you have access to the data from CQM audits or grenade inspections? And if so, would you?
Great question. we actually don't have all of the data in hand. What we have asked for is data that would allow us to benchmark the broad group of dairy producers. So it's predominantly how much milk they ship and predominantly about milk quality. So cell counts, bacteria counts, and so on. We have asked for penalty data if it's available. And that's about it. There is a CQM, a national CQM database. We have not requested those data. We thought we'll see what kind of compliance we get at this stage. I suppose we could always go back and make a supplementary request, but we're going to wait at least until we have what we hope to get in place. It's touchy because in some provinces, all of the data reside with one organization. In Ontario, for instance, Dairy Farmers of Ontario, they hold all of the payment and the regulatory data. In other provinces, the regulatory and the payment data, one is with the milk board, the other is with the provincial government. So we've had to go, in fact, to two locations and ask them to pull that together. So we tried to really pare our request down. I still think what we've asked them for, though, is data for those farm, for all farms, for a 20-month period. So all of 2014 and up to the end of August 2015. So we'll have 20 months worth of monthly data that I think will be quite powerful in looking at some of these issues and really understanding how our subsets are or aren't representative of the larger national picture. Yeah, great question. Certainly there is a demand for organic milk. I really can't comment on what proportion of the industry is organic in the U.S. And again, that's changing. It really isn't well collected in one central location. Even in Canada, there are regional pockets of organic producers. There's certainly a demand for organically produced milk. Why we haven't seen more producers switch to organic production, I think a couple of issues. Probably one of the major ones is that in that process, producers have to be able to source feed that was produced organically. And a lot of our roughages and in a lot of our grains, those aren't necessarily readily acceptable. So that's one of the challenges. And again, it's a longer process. In most provinces, there is a premium for organic milk, so there's some financial incentive, but it's sort of been a slow, there is growth, but it's been relatively slow.
So the feed, would you say, is an impediment?
It's certainly one of the challenges in accessing high-quality, organically produced feed. Yeah.
An amazing big project, mind-boggling. An aspect that I want your comment on is the financial aspects. How would you get this all done without going broke?
We're not done yet. I mean, great question. When and So when I went to Colorado and met with Jason Lombard, we met, we discussed, we thought about what could be done. Our original budget for this project was $1.7 million. Through the dairy research cluster, we got just under $1 million, about $950,000, so a little over half. At that time, we had some discussion, do we just say no, we can't do it, or do we take the Ken Leslie approach and say, we'll find the money somewhere? And this may be, it's just starting to dawn on me, this may be the common the common factor, but no, in all seriousness, we said, yeah, we'll do what we can. We've had to cut some corners. It's been tight. We haven't done everything that we hope to do in the way we hope to do it. But I think at the end of the day, and again, through the efforts of Kathy and a lot of the team in keeping costs to a minimum, our students, when they were traveling, were staying with classmates and family members. And so, I mean, everyone has done a fantastic job. Plus, we've been looking for some infusions of either cash or in kind. So the public health agency has done some testing for us. So again, a lot of ways to approach that. We're not out of the woods yet, but so far we're just barely above water. But you're right, it's always a challenge with these things, and we'll ask me in 2 years when we're all done. Then.
Any other questions? Thank you.
Thank you.